Tonight, I get the honor of introducing our speaker tonight. She's going to talk about how you deal with suffering when you feel like when you've done something that you've strayed too far from God. Emma has been one of the biggest blessings in my life over the past 4 years. And I'll never forget the day we met. I actually asked her how her wedding was. I was told that Megan was going to be at the airport in Denver, and it was Emma. So she quickly told me that it was Megan's wedding, and she was not Megan. Anyway, just to break those, yeah. Emma has been, honestly, seriously, like I said, one of the biggest blessings. I've been through some crazy stuff the past couple of years, and just being able to open up and share my story with Emma, and just knowing that she was able to open up to me and share some of her story has really been awesome and just really driven me forward the past couple months, years. But yeah, so without further ado, our speaker tonight is Emma Garner.
Appreciate your guys' grace, and I'm a little nervous, but I'm actually pretty excited now that I'm up here. I'm freaking out, but I'm going to open us up with a verse. So this is from 1 Timothy 1:15-17. This is a trustworthy saying, and everyone should accept it. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, and I am the worst of them all. But God had mercy on me, so that Christ Jesus could use me as a prime example of his great patience with even the worst sinners. Then others will realize that they too can believe in him and receive eternal life. So even though Paul wrote that to Timothy a long time ago in the Bible, I want to share with you all how my story parallels with that. So for those of you that don't know, I'm not from Michigan, I'm from Arizona. I moved about 3 years ago, but I grew up with my twin sister Megan, who's here, the married one, yes, with the adorable little one that's running around, and an older sister. And childhood growing up, we went to a Christian school, but family-wise, a little bit of background, just pretty dysfunctional. Most families are in some way. But as I went to a Christian school through third grade, started to hear about Jesus and had some faith as a youngin. And then as I went into middle school, the marriage my parents had just started to really crumble, and it was just really hard. Lived in a lot of fear that they were going to divorce, and eventually they did, going into high school. So being so young and not really sure, and they were not believers, I did not know where God was in that. And I entered into high school pretty angry. I entered in really mad, really angry at God, like, what the heck just happened? My life changed in an instant. Everything I knew blew up. And my anger and resentment I had towards him really affected the way I lived my life in high school. So, but deep down, I had this desire. I wanted to be loved, wanted, and chosen. And I felt none of that from home. Everything was a mess. And so I found everything that I was in partying, in popularity, and especially relationships, specifically one. So I got into a relationship with a guy, we'll call him Steve. And Steve, I was 15 when I met him, and he chose me. He was in a relationship with another girl, saw me at a party, and was like, I'm going to break up with her, I'm going to choose you. So of course, like, wow. So I instantly fall in love with him. We were head over heels, thought we'd be high school sweethearts, the whole shebang. And I really gave everything I was to this guy. He was it. He fulfilled my love, my everything was him. But, of course, he breaks my heart. He leaves me for my friend. And we did this on and off thing for a while. So, high school was a mess. I was a mess. I was broken. I was vulnerable. And I was still in love with him all 4 years of high school. And it was on and off, right? The whole back together and we're not. And so in this relationship, early on, I gave all myself to him. Slept with him, 15 years old. And at that time, I knew that that was wrong. And I felt unclean. I felt like I was no longer a little girl. And I was like, well, okay, I guess I've done it, so I might as well just keep doing it. Right? So that's what set the tone for high school and that relationship with him. So as we're on and off, I enter into senior year. And by this time, we're on again. He was a year older than me, and he was off in Afghanistan. He had graduated. And so we had this long-distance fling, and he was coming back on leave, and so we partied together. We lived pretty recklessly, sleep together, and everything was great. We had this really great fantasy relationship that everyone wanted. But I was really broken during that time. This love that I had with him was really not fulfilling. And as I am in my senior year of high school, preparing for graduation, college I'm going to go to, and Megan and I, we ended up trying out for the University of Arizona cheerleading team. And by the grace of God, we made it. We were terrible, but we made it. We really were terrible. But it was like, oh my gosh, we can get out. We can get out of this little town. At the time, we were in Anthem, Arizona. And I'm like, we can get out. We can get out of this mess of our family that we're in. We're going to college. So you come back, you guys all know, you come back, you make the team, and you're like a minor celebrity, right? Everyone's like, oh dang, you're going to go to D1 University, and you're going to be an athlete. And so I'm all pumped up. I'm like, yeah. And my dad is proud of me for the first time, athletics-wise, since I quit gymnastics at age 12. So he's bragging, right? He's like, oh my gosh, my little girls are going to go be cheerleaders. And so I'm having all this affirmation, like, there's the light, here I go. And a couple weeks later, plot twist. Everything changes. And I find out that I'm pregnant. And he's in Afghanistan. Happened on the time when he was on leave. I was terrified. And I had no idea what I was getting myself into. You don't really think things like that will happen until they do, until you're in it. And so here I am, and I'm heartbroken, terrified, really ashamed. I remember hating myself very much. And I kept it in. I hid it. I didn't even tell Megan at this time. Didn't tell my parents. Hid it, and I was like, crap, what am I gonna do? I really wrestled with this. And I'm like, oh my gosh, what do I do? I'm gonna go to college, right? What do I do? So, Steve was in Afghanistan, and we'll never forget the phone call that as I was wrestling with this decision, I decided I'm gonna tell him I wanna have the baby, right? We are in love, we're gonna get married, right? He told me. He told me for 3 years that he loved me and he was going to be with me. And so I tell him on the phone, he's 19 at the time, and I'm telling him, like, yeah, you know, I think I want to have this baby with you, but I want to do this with you. I don't want to be alone. I don't want to raise in a broken home. Will you do this with me? And he said, no, I'm sorry. So I was faced with a choice, and still, no one knew. So I did make a choice to have an abortion right before going into college. And right after I did was when I told Megan. But that was by far the lowest point of my life. And I need this. I'm like dizzy right now. Sorry guys, it's hard to talk about. going into college, I was a mess. But it's like, well, there's hope, right? Like, I was in all this shame and all this guilt. I'm like, well, if I go to college, no one knows me there. No one knows. I can just start new. I don't have to ever tell anyone. Now here I am telling you guys. I thought I would take it to the grave. I really did. I was so ashamed of what I had done. And so I went into college, and I just carried it. Carried it with me, this weight. And yeah, so... So as I went into college thinking I could start new, I didn't, because this resentment and this anger and this guilt and this shame was still with me. It haunted me every day for 4 years in college. And my life still reflected that. So I fell into same similar patterns of partying, same similar patterns of relationships. And so that just continued. It was this endless cycle. Of just trying to prove and trying to feel loved and wanted. And I didn't. I wasn't finding it. And so I was pretty depressed in college and no one knew. Again, taking it to the grave, no one was gonna know. I was very ashamed. I was really suffering. And at this time, where was God as far as how I viewed him? Yeah, I thought he was done with me. Yeah, no way. There's no way that God would forgive me. There's no way he loves me. I'm definitely 100% crossed off that list to heaven. And I actually remember thinking that very clearly, like, oh, I'm screwed. And I'm just going to accept it. So it was pretty dark during that time. And how David describes it in Psalm 32, 3 and 4, he said, "For when I kept silent, my bones wasted away. Through my groaning all day long, for day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer." So this pain I was going through, it was hard. But as I look back, it was the turning point of my life. It was when God pulled me back to him in this really hard time. So as you guys know, right, you guys are in college. You're athletes. There's a lot of things tugging on you. There's a lot of things trying to get your attention and your affection, and a lot of things promising you love that won't follow through. So all these things were pulling on me. And it was so comfortable being miserable. It really was. Sooner or later, you're like, well, I'm just going to be miserable for the rest of my life, and I'm just going to accept it. So then on one end, though, in this pain, God was tugging on my heart. He really was. How does God pursue us in that? Even though I was running in the opposite direction, I literally, you guys, the least likely person to be sitting in the seats you're in right now, running the opposite direction, but God pursued me. He pulled on my heart by placing a Christian on my team. Her name is Julia. She's one of my best friends still to this day. And she was, I thought, a total weirdo. And it's like, this girl is a Jesus freak, and we have nothing in common, literally. And I was like, but she's so kind. There was this purity about her that my heart really longed for that I never thought I would have. And I really liked her. So we started hanging out. And God used her so much in my life. I mean, I was so attracted to the person she was. She had this joy. I had no joy. We were talking on the phone the other day. She's like, you were miserable. And I was like, I know. I can't even remember that. But she knows me. She's like, you were just awful to hang out with. But she was just this joy. I was. I know. But I really was. And so I started hanging out with her. And she invited me to AIA every single week. Every week. I went one time. In 3 years. Once. So I think she started getting hints. She invited Megan. So Megan started coming. And so Megan started coming to AIA. And she's like, all right, well, I'll just bring Megan. But She still invited me to Bible studies, still wanted to be invested in my life, hung out all the time, and I just loved her. And Megan ended up getting super involved with AIA and gave her life to Christ through UTC, where she met Joe. And so Megan comes back completely transformed. So all these people around me are all these joyful people, and I'm trying to be miserable, and they're ruining it. And I'm like, you guys, what is going on here? And so she goes back her senior year to intern at the camp. And Megan knows my story at this time. She knows I hated myself so much. I looked at myself every day in the mirror and was like, you suck. You deserve to die. You're awful. That was my self-talk. And so when Megan comes back, totally transformed, I'm like, gosh, like, they're really real about this. Like, this seems legit. And so she comes back, and I start to ask her, I'm like, Megan, is there any hope for someone like me? She's like, yeah, there is, right? She's all excited to talk to me about it. And I just asked her these questions, like, am I too far gone? Because at the time I did. I truly believed that my sin, what I did, was not forgivable at all. And I hated myself, and so I just started asking him, like, does God even love me? How does he view me? Does he care? And most of all, as she started, as God was pursuing me in these years through these women in my life, I started to see maybe I could be made new. Maybe I could start over and not be chained to this anymore and not be haunted by this anymore. And maybe I could forgive myself. So that was the first time in the conversation with Megan that I heard the truth about who God was. That in fact, you can come as you are, completely broken, a hot mess, ratchet. Just awful. You can come to him. In fact, Romans 5 tells us that Christ died for us while we were doing that. In our sin, Jesus died for you. Not when you were good, not when you had it all together, not when you got all cleaned up, you know, I'll just get right before I become a Christian. You can't. Christ makes you right. You cannot do it on your own. And so she starts telling me this. I'm like, wait, what? Like, I can come as I am? She said, yeah. Yeah, your sin's covered. In fact, you're completely forgiven. I'm like, there's no way. There's no way. Ephesians 1:7 tells us, though, he's so rich in kindness and grace that he purchased our freedom with the blood of his son and forgave our sins. That's it. Is your sin too big for the cross? The answer is no. It's not. It's not too big for the cross. And as we started talking about forgiveness, man, we were just talking about this yesterday. She remembers stuff from the conversation that I don't. But she told me, and I do remember this. She said, you're never going to forgive yourself until you accept forgiveness. Is that the way you want to live? She's like, are you ever going to accept it? Because it's yours. Do you know Jesus died for you? I said, I know he died on the cross. She's like, are you going to accept it or not? Total sister, like, what are you waiting for? And so what does that look like, though? How does that happen? How can I just go from living this life to all of a sudden I'm forgiven? And it's just acknowledge your sin. Psalm 32:5. I acknowledge my sin to you. I did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. There's no catch. I remember, is there a catch? She's like, no, it's grace. So what the heck is grace? She's like, well, it's for everyone. God sent Jesus on the cross for your sin. And it's forgiven. He knew before you had the abortion, you were going to do it, and he died for it. You're a nail in his hand. That was the first time I actually sat there and thought, someone loves me that much to do that for me? Because I didn't love myself that much at all. Isaiah 1:18. Come now, let's settle this, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, I will make them white as snow. That's our God. That's our God, you guys. Completely wiped clean. All you have to do is confess it and acknowledge it. That's crazy to me. My favorite part of what Megan shared with me was that you're a new creation in Christ. You can be made new because I hated who I'd become. I hated the person. I remember being this little third grader who loved Jesus, and all of a sudden now I'm this college girl who's carrying all this baggage, who can't even look at herself in the mirror. She said, you can be made new. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old has passed away. The new has come. That was the greatest news of all time. Those who look to him are radiant. Their faces shall never be ashamed. Your shame is gone. You don't have to put yourself in this cloak of shame anymore, Emma. You can let go. You can look to Jesus, and he's not looking at you, shaking his head like, I can't believe you did that. He's saying, look at me. Your face is radiant. You're clean. You're beautiful. You're pure. Galatians 2:20. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. And that's my life right now. That's my life since October 2013, when I said yes to Jesus. I knew it logically. There's a difference. There's a difference of knowing the truth and actually accepting it in your heart, because it will transform you. And October 2013, I was like, oh my gosh, Jesus is it. He's worth living your life for, all in, 2 feet in, all the way. Jump off the cliff, go for it. He's worth it. He died for what I did. He pursued me. He wanted me to return to him. He pulled on me. Who does that? There's no love like this on this earth. He's it. So now here I am, 4 years out of college, working in ministry. Who would have thought? Who would have thought? All those interviews that I had when I was in a senior year of college, like you guys are doing right now, some of you. Where do you see yourself in 5 years? Didn't see myself in Michigan State, working in athletic ministry. My life radically changed. God had a purpose. He wanted to use that very, very broken time in my life. And he says, return. You guys, God wants you to return to him. He tells us in Jeremiah 3:12-15, return, faithless Israel, declares the Lord. I will not look on you in anger, for I am merciful. I will not be angry forever. Just acknowledge your guilt that you rebelled against the Lord your God and that you have disobeyed my voice. Return, for I'm your master, and I will give you shepherds after my own heart who will feed you with knowledge and understanding. Isn't that wild? I can't believe it. I can't believe that this sin and the terrible things that we do, our God tells us that. Return. That's his heart. His arms are open. They're not crossed. They're not pushing you away, even though the world will tell you that. And you don't have to do anything. You just have to say, okay, I want that. I want a relationship with you, God. So, one story. So, you know, guys, one of the main things I always get asked after I do share, which I've never shared in front of a group, as I told you earlier, is, you know, how often do you think about it? Such a funny question. I'm like, well, every day. Every day. But now, as I've grown in my faith and I've grown in knowing who Jesus is, when I think about it, I think of grace. I think that I don't deserve a relationship with God, but he pursues me. It's like a relationship you've totally screwed up. You've done everything wrong. We talked about this last night. You've done everything wrong, but he pursues you still. Mm. That's our God. I'm going to believe it. So as I have been walking with the Lord, and as I think about it now, I see the cross. I see my need for Jesus. I see my need for a Savior. And if I didn't go through that, would I have gotten it? Would I have gotten the message that I'm so broken and in need for someone to save me from death? Would I have gotten it? I don't know. And so to stand up here with you guys today and share one of the most difficult times of my life, God has used drastically to show me who he is, to show me his powerful love. And still now, I struggle. Walking with Jesus is not easy. It's not an easy road. And so I'm always wanting to go, I want to go back to see who is Jesus. How did Jesus walk the earth? Because he's a reflection, the exact replica of God. As he walked on this earth, God sent Jesus so we could see who God is, his character. He's perfect. And the life of Jesus was not one shaking his head like, I can't sit with you because you're too dirty and you messed up and you're too far gone. No, Jesus' life was all about kindness towards sinners, kindness towards people who totally screwed up, that everyone else is judging. That's Jesus. He tells us a story. There's many stories, but my favorite one, if you've been hanging out with me recently, I've probably gone through it with you in the Bible, is John 8, the woman caught in adultery. How does Jesus respond to a woman who's totally worthy of shame and judgment? How does Jesus respond? So there's these guys back in the day called the Pharisees, and they're the ones that had all their stuff together, right? They were living good, they were following all the laws, and they were doing everything right. And so they see this woman caught in adultery in John 8. There's this woman who has totally screwed up, totally blown it. She's caught in adultery. What do? They throw her at the feet of Jesus while he's teaching. So he's in the middle of teaching to a crowd, and they bring in this woman. She's probably dirty, beaten, tears on her face, ashamed. And these guys throw her at Jesus' feet. They said, what are you going to do about her? She's an adulterous woman. And Jesus gets me every time. He tells them, let the one who's never sinned throw the first stone. And when they heard that, they started to slip away. Oldest to the youngest, all these guys. And there she is. She's sitting there. She's alone with Jesus. He's the only one that's never sinned. So he's the only one worthy of casting the first stone. Does he? No, he doesn't cast a stone. He gets on her level, lifts her face, says, woman, where are your accusers? Where are they? Didn't even one of them condemn you, shame you, judge you? Didn't any one of them do that right now? No, Lord. And Jesus said, neither do I. Go and sin no more. That's Jesus. That's the guy I want to be in a relationship with. That when you totally blow it, he picks up your face and says, I'm in this with you. I love you. I'm not going to cast a stone at you, but I want a relationship with you. His kindness leads to repentance. It leads to us saying, I don't want to do this anymore. It led to me saying, I don't want to live this way anymore. I want to stop sleeping with my boyfriend. I want to stop being used. I want to stop partying. I want to stop ruining my life. Because people he placed in my life were so kind, reflecting him, loving me, accepting me. That's Jesus. It leads us to a repentance which leads to transformation. It says, go and sin no more. And that's a shocking kindness. It's shocking. He enters our shame with us, and he wants to rewrite our story. He wants to use really broken times in our life and wants to use them for his glory. He wants to say, show them who I am. Show them how much I love you.
And that I'm good.
My grace is sufficient, and his love is steadfast. It doesn't waver, ever. So I'm going to close with the same verse I opened with to just bring it back together. Maybe you can resonate with it too. This is a trustworthy saying, and everyone should accept it. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, and I am the worst of them all. But God had mercy on me so that Christ Jesus could use me as a prime example of his great patience with even the worst sinners. Then others will realize that they too can believe in him and receive eternal life. All honor and glory to God forever and ever. He is the eternal King, the unseen one who never dies. He alone is God. So that's my story.